Autism: How to Raise a Happy Autistic Child, written by Jessie Hewitson, read by Lucy Scott. Autism. Jessie Hewitson is an award-winning journalist at The Times and has freelanced for various national newspapers and magazines, including The Sunday Times and The Telegraph. She also edited Tatler Magazine's 2013 Guide to the UK's Best Doctors. She lives in London and is a mother of two. Her 7-year-old son is autistic. Foreword. For many families, receiving a diagnosis of autism for their child is a life-changing moment. It can unlock access to the right support and provide an explanation for why they may be struggling to cope in nursery or in school. It's the result of a long and hard-fought journey for the support they so desperately need. But it is just the beginning. While awareness of autism has increased, understanding of autism still has a long way to go. Alongside the relief of a diagnosis, parents often feel panic and confusion as they attempt to navigate their way towards an understanding of this disability. A quick Google of autism returns millions of results, some reliable and many ill-informed. There are numerous medical journals packed full of important research, but it's lengthy and difficult to wade through the jargon. It is easy to feel confused and overwhelmed in the first years after diagnosis. All any parent or carer wants for their child is for them to be happy and supported to achieve their potential. For parents and carers of children with autism, knowledge is power. In this book, Jessie Hewitson, the mother of a child with autism, has done much of the hard work for you. Pairing the most up-to-date research and information on autism with the experiences of people with autism themselves makes for a powerful and enlightening read. It is also an incredibly useful and accessible guide to autism, which debunks common myths and breaks down medical and educational jargon into plain English. Underpinned throughout by Jessie's own experience, this is a refreshingly honest and candid insight into the many challenges, but also the joys, of raising a child with autism. The result is an important book that will no doubt become an invaluable source of support for any parent who suspects or has been told that their child has autism. The journey that Jessie describes in this book, from the stumbling blocks she encounters trying to get a diagnosis to the challenge of securing the right support in school, is one that will be all too familiar for parents of children with autism. As any parent knows, when you have a child, you enter a daunting new world. As well as the joy and love you feel, there is also anxiety about the road ahead. For parents of autistic children, this journey feels even more difficult and fraught with challenges. It's easy to see why. There are still far too many barriers in society preventing children with autism from fulfilling their potential. At Ambitious About Autism, our mission is to break down these barriers and make the ordinary possible for children and young people with autism. This could be making sure they have access to an education that meets their needs, to finding a job, or simply finding acceptance. We were founded by a small group of parents in 1997 who were determined to challenge the lack of education and support for their children's needs. Starting out with a handful of students, we have gone on to expand our services to help thousands of young people. We now run specialist schools and colleges for young people with complex autism at 4 sites across London. Education is key, and we must keep pushing for change to ensure no child with autism is let down by the system. This begins with greater understanding and awareness of autism among teachers and classroom staff. Ambitious About Autism campaigned for basic autism training to be made a mandatory part of all teachers' initial training, and we're pleased this is now a reality. But it's crucial that all teachers, not just newly qualified ones, as well as support staff and classroom assistants, receive autism training as part of their ongoing professional development. The more school staff appreciate and value the differences in autistic children, the better their ability to offer them the support they need to succeed. The book you are about to listen to is very honest about the problems that continue to exist for children with autism, many of which are rooted in a lack of understanding. But listening to it will reassure parents that they are not alone and will equip them with vital knowledge to help themselves and their children. It is above all a book that is hopeful and ambitious about autism, something that very much resonates with our charity's work. While its practical advice does not sugarcoat or shy away from any of the difficulties that await parents, this is a book that celebrates difference and champions happiness. It's a message all of us can support, whether you have a connection to autism or not. For, as the author so eloquently puts it early on, what is so brilliant about being normal? Yolanta Lazotta, Chief Executive of Ambitious About Autism. Introduction. An expert is a person who has found out by his own painful experience all the mistakes that one can make in a very narrow field. Niels Bohr, Danish physicist, awarded the 1922 Nobel Prize in Physics. Lots of mothers and fathers will tell you they didn't know what they were doing when their newborn baby was first handed to them. But if your child is autistic and you aren't, then you really don't know what you're doing, and most likely won't for years. Because you and your child are fundamentally different in the way you think, how you perceive the world, how you communicate, and how you play. All the while, though, you're both likely to be thinking you're the same. To put it a different way, imagine you are a British person married to a fellow Brit, brought up in this country and used to the culture, food, and language. You then have a child together and discover, when the child is 5 years old, that they are actually from, say, France, a different culture. They find some of your food disgusting. They speak another language. It's a hell of a shock. But eventually it makes sense. This is why you felt so at sea and found it hard to communicate with them. You knew on an intuitive level there was a difference, but you couldn't put your finger on it. You blame the fact they're French. That's the reason I can't play with my baby or soothe them, you tell yourself. You also blame yourself. How did I not realise for all these years that my own child came from a different country? You start to imagine what it must have been like for them to have a parent who didn't understand their experiences were so different. But the problem isn't that they are French. The problem is the not realising your child is French, as well as not knowing much about France. Once you take language classes, things get a lot better. This happened to me when my son was diagnosed at the age of 2. I thought autism was the reason he wasn't happy, and I hated it. I felt it had robbed my child of the life I wanted for him. Gradually, though, I realised he was unhappy, not because he was autistic, but because the people around him didn't have a clue about autism. My husband and I only knew the horrible stereotypes. We didn't know what he needed. It is this knowledge gap that needs to be tackled, not the autism. I'm hoping this book will speed up this process by giving you a lot of what you need to know in one place, by telling you it's going to be okay. It's the book containing everything I wish I had known from the very beginning. Information it has taken me years to gain, sometimes by learning some very hard lessons. The other key message of this book is, what is so brilliant about being normal? We use the word average as an insult in every concept except when a child is developing differently. Then suddenly, it's the thing to aspire to. Let's not aim for average. Let's aim for happiness. It may not be easy to achieve when your child has a different brain nationality to your own, but you've come to the right place to start figuring out how to get there. A few notes about writing this book. I realised halfway through that I had made a mistake. I was writing a book about autism by interviewing non-autistic people. It seemed as ridiculous as interviewing only men for a book about feminism. The penny dropped after I spoke to a few autistic adults. I started again, this time making autistic adults central to the book. I'm so pleased I did. Not just because it was the right thing to do, but because this way I got the best advice and insight. I also wasn't aware of the role language plays in the discussion of autism. This changed when I saw my son reading an article about autism in the kids' newspaper we subscribe to. I felt panicky when he turned the page and I saw the headline. I was worried the piece would talk about autism sufferers and leave him feeling like he had a disorder. It didn't. Gold star, first news. So, message received. Language matters very much. The words we choose reflect our unconscious bias. In my writing, I now refer to autistic people as precisely that. Autistic people, not people with autism. People with autism have a medical condition, as if you can somehow separate the autism from the person. Autistic people's autism is part of who they are. Similarly, I reject the notion of autism as a calamity or a medical disorder, so I have steered clear of terms such as impairment, disorder, severe autism, or people being at risk of autism. Terms such as high-functioning and low-functioning are also misleading, as I explain later in the book. In direct quotes, however, I have used people's own terminology. 1. Defining autism.
Nature never draws a line without smudging it.
Winston Churchill, frequently quoted by Lorna Wing. Until I started researching this book, I had never actually read the criteria for the diagnosis my son received back in 2012. When I did, I was horrified. According to the ICD-10, the World Health Organization's International Statistical Classification of Diseases and Related Health Problems, the diagnostic manual most commonly used by UK doctors, childhood autism is a disorder that is usually diagnosed in early childhood. The main signs and symptoms of autism involve communication, social interactions, and repetitive behaviors. Children with autism might have problems talking with you, or they might not look you in the eye when you talk to them. They may spend a lot of time putting things in order before they can pay attention, or they may say the same sentence again and again to calm themselves down. They often seem to be in their own world. Because people with autism can have very different features or symptoms, healthcare providers think of autism as a spectrum disorder. Asperger syndrome is a milder version of the disorder. The cause of autism is not known. Autism lasts throughout a person's lifetime. There is no cure, but treatment can help. It adds, type of autism is characterized by very early detection, less than 30 months, social coldness, grossly impaired communication, and bizarre motor responses. Had I read this definition when my son was being assessed, I'm sure I would have felt total panic. Back then, I too looked at what he wasn't doing compared with non-autistic children the same age and thought this was the problem. I saw autism as a disorder and being non-autistic as the goal. While my knowledge of autism at this stage was limited, the medical profession doesn't have the same excuse. You would think at the very least its definitions should be objective, but this one is not. It contains several value judgments. Describing someone as socially cold is a highly offensive way of describing social difference, as is labelling particular motor responses bizarre and communication grossly impaired. I wonder if the gravely portentous declaration that there is no cure but treatment can help will come back to haunt the compilers of the ICD-10 in years to come. In a couple of decades, we may be as amused, horrified, to read these words as we are today to see the sexist, Mad Men-style ad campaigns of the 1950s. Increasingly, the medical view of autism as a disorder or impairment is being challenged. Take, for example, the man responsible for the iPhone in your pocket. With his single-mindedness, attention to detail, and ability to think differently, the late Steve Jobs is seen by many autistic people as a kindred spirit. You wouldn't call him impaired, would you? In fact, you'd probably say he functioned at an envy-inducing level. Or what about the many autistic people who have found their significant other, started a family, and are leading happy, fulfilled lives? Are they socially cold? The clinical definition is meaningless for them. To try to highlight how skewed the medical take on autism is, have a listen to the definition of homosexuality in the ICD-9, compiled in 1977. Exclusive or predominant sexual attraction for persons of the same sex with or without physical relationship. Doesn't sound too bad. It is listed under sexual deviations and disorders, which are defined as abnormal sexual inclinations or behaviour which are part of a referral problem. The limits and features of normal sexual inclination and behaviour have not been stated absolutely in different societies and cultures, but are broadly such as serve approved social and biological purposes. The sexual activity of affected persons is directed primarily either towards people not of the opposite sex, or towards sexual acts not associated with coitus normally, or towards coitus performed under abnormal circumstances. It is preferable not to include in this category individuals who perform deviant sexual acts when normal sexual outlets are not available to them. This view of homosexuality, particularly that last hilarious get-out clause, now seems just embarrassing. Yet it was there, in black and white, in the WHO's manual until 1990, when it was dropped from the newly minted ICD-10. While the current edition's definition of autism is misguided in many ways and will hopefully be reworded when the next one appears in coming years, it is mainly wrong because it measures autism against a non-autistic benchmark and finds it lacking. Since autistic people are not of the usual order, not normal, then they must be disordered, abnormal. If the compilers of the ICD-11 are looking for a fairer definition, they could do worse than consider this take offered by Nick Walker, an autistic author, Aikido teacher and psychology professor in the US, on his blog www.neurocosmopolitanism.com. Autism produces distinctive, atypical ways of thinking, moving, interacting, and sensory and cognitive processing. One analogy that has often been made is that autistic individuals have a different neurological operating system than non-autistic individuals. He adds that while autism is still widely regarded as a disorder, this view has been challenged in recent years by proponents of the neurodiversity model, which holds that autism and other neurocognitive variants are simply part of the natural spectrum of human biodiversity, like variations in ethnicity or sexual orientation, which have been pathologized in the past. Amen to that. In fact, rather than trying to pin down what autism is, I think it's more helpful to say what it isn't. It isn't a barrier to having friends, getting married, having a happy, fulfilled life, evolving or changing, learning, being close to your parents, caring about other people, having a job, being good at sport, feeling empathy or emotions. Quite the opposite. Autistic people can feel emotions very intensely. But then neither is it a passport to understanding the mysteries of mathematics or computing, nor the key to making millions at a Las Vegas blackjack table. While autistic people are at a considerable disadvantage because they live in a sense-overloading world that doesn't understand and rarely makes allowances for them, arguably what disadvantages them most is being constantly defined by what they can't do rather than what they can. A history of autism in 7 people. Hans Asperger. In the 1930s, the Austrian paediatrician Hans Asperger, 1906 to 1980, began noticing a particular set of characteristics among children he was studying in Vienna. He called the condition autism psychopathy, using a word first coined in 1910 by the Swiss psychologist Eugen Bleuler, to describe the tendency among his schizophrenic patients to become detached, interacting not with their immediate environments, but with their interior worlds. Asperger's views on autism were decades ahead of their time. He believed autism was common and heritable, that it needed to be adapted to rather than cured, that it was a lifelong condition requiring special forms of support from family, schools, and the community. He identified what would come to be known as the spectrum theory, the idea that autism impacts people in different ways, leaving some unable to speak and others capable of discoursing at length about their special and very specific interests, such as the little professors at his clinic. He also recognized that having exceptional talents in some areas did not preclude a child from having profound difficulties in others. He kept tabs on one boy, Fritz V, long after he had left the clinic. Fritz V had shown a very severe impairment in social integration and at school quickly became aggressive and lashed out with anything he could get hold of, once with a hammer. The boy showed an astonishing facility for mathematics, however. He gained a place at university on his way to becoming an assistant professor of astronomy and discovered a mistake in the work of Isaac Newton. There has always been doubt over Asperger's role in the Nazi Party. Research published in 2018 shows he was far more involved than previously thought and willingly selected disabled children to be euthanized, though there is no evidence that he signed a death warrant for any of the autistic children at his school. It had been reported that he was a passionate defender of difference, but the truth appears to be far more complex and disturbing. In 1944, he published a paper on his work on autism, but the conflagration in Europe meant it went largely unnoticed. A lot of his early work was also lost when his school clinic was bombed towards the end of the Second World War. The war arguably delayed the understanding of the autism spectrum and left its definition to another doctor, one with a very different view of autism. Leo Kanner. Born during the days of the Austro-Hungarian Empire in what is now Ukraine, Leo Kanner, 1894 to 1981, was a child psychiatrist who relocated to the US in 1924. There, at around the same time as Asperger, but around 4,000 miles away, he too was beginning to identify autism in the children he was observing. In 1943, while working at the Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland, Kanner published his seminal study on autism, coincidentally using the same word as Asperger to describe the condition. Although he was not yet aware of Asperger's work, the younger man referenced Kanner's paper in his own the following year. Kanner based his findings on observations of 11 young people, among them Donald Triplett, written up as Case 1, the first person in the world to be diagnosed as autistic. Kanner noted that the youngsters seemed to inhabit their own private worlds, ignoring people around them, including their own parents, and were able to amuse themselves for hours by flapping their hands in front of their faces. Autism, he concluded, was a rare and serious condition with a narrow definition. By the 1950s, he had only diagnosed 50 cases of true autism. While Kanner and Asperger had identified similar characteristics in their subjects, their interpretations were hugely different. Kanner saw autism in a negative light, and his recommendation to parents who brought their children to see him was to send them away to institutions and forget about them. He assumed autistic people were beyond help, uneducable. Because they were sent to institutions where they were taught nothing, this view stayed unchallenged for decades. Kanner was in part responsible for the theory of the refrigerator mother. In 1949, he suggested autism may be related to a genuine lack of maternal warmth, observing that the children were left neatly in refrigerators which did not defrost. Their withdrawal seems to be an act of turning away from such a situation to seek comfort in solitude. In a 1960 interview, he went further, bluntly condemning parents of autistic children as having happened to defrost enough to produce a child. The psychoanalyst Bruno Bettelheim, a professor of psychology at the University of Chicago, born in Vienna 3 years before Asperger, took this idea and ran with it. Thanks to him, the refrigerator mother theory became mainstream, accepted by the medical establishment and public alike. Yet when Bettelheim died, it was discovered that his expertise in psychoanalysis amounted to 3 introductory classes in psychology, and that his claims to have met and been praised by the father of psychoanalysis, Sigmund Freud, were false. as a result of Kanner's observations and Bettelheim's now discredited theories, autism became linked with shame and stigma, with autistic children continuing to be sent to institutions and mothers being told it was all their fault. Kanner later backtracked, claiming his work had been hijacked by Bettelheim. In the early 1970s, the British psychiatrist Michael Rutter carried out research looking at non-identical and identical twins where one sibling was autistic. This proved a genetic component to autism for the first time. Lorna Wing. A better understanding still was developed in the 1970s by the British psychiatrist Lorna Wing and her assistant, the British psychotherapist Judith Gould. While Wing respected Kanner for having identified autism, she doubted his conclusion that it was rare and set out to prove otherwise. As the mum of an autistic daughter, Susie, she also knew that the refrigerator mother theory was, in her words, bloody stupid. It was Wing who stumbled upon Hans Asperger's work. In the late 70s, while looking into the incidence rate of autism, she unearthed his 1944 paper written in German. Her husband, John Wing, a German speaker, was the first to translate it into English. Asperger's paper chimed with Wing's research and led in the 1980s to the formulation of her spectrum theory of autism. The autistic children Asperger had observed in the 1930s were for the most part more in line with their non-autistic peers, while those being studied by Kanner had more complex needs. The pair, she surmised, had identified the same condition but at different points on a continuum. Autism, she concluded, was a spectrum, meaning the condition was likely to be anything but rare. She also introduced the term Asperger syndrome to indicate autistic children with little or no communication delay and no cognitive difficulties. Asperger syndrome was given formal recognition a decade later when it was included in the International Classification of Diseases. If the story of autism so far sounds like something Hollywood might have conjured up, perhaps it won't surprise you to see Tom Cruise stepping into shot. In 1988, the film Rain Man came out, starring Cruise as the brother of an autistic savant, played by Dustin Hoffman. It won 4 Oscars and brought autism to the attention of the world, where previously only a small number of professionals knew about it. These 2 incidents, Wing's realization that autism was far more prevalent than previously thought, and the success of Rain Man, is one explanation for the spike in diagnoses that occurred in the 1980s and 1990s. For most of the 20th century, autism had indeed been very rare. Then suddenly, it wasn't. In a short space of time, most people knew of someone with a diagnosis. Andrew Wakefield. In 1998, a British gastroenterologist, Andrew Wakefield, claimed there was another reason for this sudden rise in diagnoses, the MMR, measles, mumps and rubella vaccine, which he concluded was causing autism. His controversial study, published in The Lancet, was widely publicised. Sensationalist newspaper headlines screamed that an autism epidemic had been triggered by the triple MMR vaccine. Wakefield's study was found to be fraudulent, however, and he was reported to have been paid more than £435,000 by lawyers acting on behalf of parents who believed their children had been harmed by the vaccine. In 2010, he was found guilty of serious professional misconduct and struck off the medical register. The final nail in the coffin for Wakefield's claims came in 2014, when a review of more than 1.2 million children established no link between the triple MMR vaccine and autism. Neither Wakefield nor those journalists looking for a disaster angle understood that the increase in diagnoses was a good thing. Thanks to the work of Hans Asperger, Lorna Wing and Judith Gould, children and adults were at last having their differences and difficulties recognised and beginning to get the support they needed. There was never an epidemic. Autism was instead being recognised as a common part of the human condition for the first time. The latest estimate by America's Centers for Disease Control and Prevention puts the number of autistic children at 1 in 68. Jim Sinclair. The spike in diagnoses during the 1980s and 1990s saw an accompanying spike in panic among parents. Autism conventions were held to discuss the urgent need to find a cure. Mothers and fathers spoke about the tragedy of having a child with autism. Those children rarely, if ever, got podium space to share their thoughts. One autistic man, Jim Sinclair, described by the author Steve Silberman as the Martin Luther King of the autism rights movement, had attended such conventions. He had had enough. In 1993, he requested to speak at the International Conference on Autism in Toronto. There, before an audience of parents and professionals, he delivered his now famous "Don't Mourn for Us" speech, an anti-cure perspective on autism. He told the conference, "You didn't lose a child to autism. You lost a child because the child you waited for never came into existence. That isn't the fault of the autistic child who does exist, and it shouldn't be our burden. We need and deserve families who can see us and value us for ourselves, not families whose vision of us is obscured by the ghosts of children who never lived. Grieve if you must for your own lost dreams, but don't mourn for us. We are alive. We are real." This speech was a turning point. The idea that the condition is a difference rather than a life-destroying tragedy was now part of the conversation. Neurotypical syndrome. In 1998, an autistic woman known as Muskie set up a website for a made-up organization, the Institute for the Study of Neurologically Typical, on which she posted the following satirical definition of neurotypical syndrome. NB, neurotypical means non-autistic. What is NT? Neurotypical syndrome is a neurobiological disorder characterized by preoccupation with social concerns, delusions of superiority, and obsession with conformity. How common is it? Tragically, as many as 9,625 cases out of every 10,000 individuals may be neurotypical. Are there any treatments for it? There is no known cure for neurotypical syndrome. Judy Singer. In 1998, Judy Singer, an Australian autism rights scholar writing her sociology thesis, coined the word neurodiversity. The term is a powerful one, suggesting, as it does, that our minds and brains, in their infinite variety, are part of a spectrum of human diversity. It invites us to view neurological difference in the same way as we view sexual orientation or cultural diversity. While the medical view stated there was one way to be, and that way is normal, anything that deviates from normal is a disorder or a deficit. The neurodiversity paradigm questions the assumption that there is only one right way of being, argued Nick Walker in a talk he gave on autistic identity at the University of California, Davis, in October 2014. In the past, it was thought that there was only one right ethnicity. Everyone else was inferior or savages. In 2005, a charity was founded in the US with the goal of curing autism and addressing the global health crisis it represented. Autism Speaks, backed by wealthy benefactors, spent millions of dollars per year funding research to achieve its aim. In 2016, it announced it was dropping the search for a cure from its mission statement and has since removed from its website and literature references to struggles, hardship, and crisis. There is now a movement among autistic adults to encourage people to accept their difference and for non-autistic people to find out from autistic adults what autism is all about. Neurodiversity is a fact, like all kinds of diversity. Human diversity, ecological diversity, says Virginia Bovell, mother of Danny Hornby, a young autistic man with severe to profound learning disabilities. Danny's father and Virginia's ex-husband is the writer Nick Hornby. When it becomes linked to your belief systems, it becomes more than that, though. it becomes a fact that's celebrated and promoted. If you were to advocate for neurodiversity, you'd be saying, we don't need to make everyone the same. We shouldn't require autistic people to behave as if they weren't autistic. It's about a quality of respect and a quality of taking people seriously. Studies have explored how autistic people behave in certain circumstances versus neurotypicals, and how sometimes researchers have viewed in a bad light the positive attributes of autism. It's just assumed the neurotypicals are doing the right thing. In one study, autistic and neurotypical people were observed in an experiment involving donating money to charity. The autistic people continued to give the same way as they did when not observed, but the neurotypicals behaved more generously when they were being observed. The study was written up as if they were somehow wrong for not being governed by what others might think of them. Donald Triplett. Donald Triplett, Leo Kanner's case one, is now 84 and still living in Mississippi, in the same house he grew up in. He was sent to an institution at the age of 3 on the advice of doctors and was expected to die there. His parents, however, changed their minds a year later and brought him home. The boy they were advised to forget has forged a life, built a group of friends, has the support and acceptance of his community. He gets around town in a Cadillac, plays golf every day, and enjoys travelling. He has visited more than 20 countries on his own. The authors of In a Different Key, The Story of Autism, John Donovan and Karen Zucker, interviewed Triplett over a number of years, writing for BBC News magazine in 2016 that even though he still has obsessions and talks rather mechanically and cannot really hold a conversation beyond one or two rounds of exchanged pleasantries, he is a fully fledged personality, a pleasure to hang out with, and a friend. They added, what Donald's story suggests is that parents hearing for the first time that a child is autistic should understand that with this particular diagnosis, the die is never cast. Each individual has a unique capacity to grow and learn, as Donald did, even if he hit most of his milestones rather later than most people. For example, he learned to drive only in his late 20s. This is why the medical definition of autism feels so incomplete. I don't recognize my son in it, and nor does it do justice to Donald Triplett. Triplett is now a happy retiree, an active part of his community, enjoying a life very different to the one that nearly was his lot, had his parents not taken him out of the institution. Had he been left, Triplett would no doubt have fulfilled the horrible definition of autism set down in the ICD-10, but he was lucky to have parents who didn't define him in medical terms alone. Who would have guessed in the 1940s that case one in Kanner's report would lead a fulfilling life and now be travelling the world on his own? I certainly had no idea, back when my son was diagnosed, how well he'd be doing at the age of 7. 2. Is my child autistic? It's really important to share the idea that being different might feel like a problem at the time, but ultimately diversity is a strength. Carson Lee Cressley, fashion expert on the American television program Queer Eye for the Straight Guy. I first heard the word autism in relation to my son when he was 1, and we were staying with my mother-in-law, a retired educational psychologist. I told her I was worried he wasn't happy. I felt he didn't need me. She raised the possibility of him being autistic. I was taken aback. The thought had never occurred to me, most likely because I knew nothing about autism. So I did what everyone does in a time of crisis. I turned to the internet. On YouTube, I came across a video of an autistic boy flapping his hands at the dinner table, exactly the same hand flapping my son did. This must be it, I thought. I had always known there was something different about him and about our relationship. It must be because he was autistic. I panicked. I spoke to a health visitor about my son's lack of eye contact and mentioned autism. She watched him for a minute, put the cap back on her pen, handed me back his red book health record, and told me he wasn't. I felt a burst of relief. But this quickly faded when we got back to the flat. I still couldn't play with him. I couldn't get him to look at me. The nagging feeling returned. I visited the GP, who said she didn't think he was autistic but would refer him just in case. We saw a speech and language therapist, SLT, who told me my son wasn't autistic but did have an attachment disorder. Well, hearing that felt like getting hit on the head with a baseball bat. This woman, in her early 20s, had confirmed that whatever was happening was down to my shit mothering, a possibility I already worried about every hour of the day. I phoned up my mother-in-law and burst into tears. She was brilliant. She told me the SLT didn't know what she was talking about and told me to have confidence in what I thought was happening. It is all about confidence, isn't it? So many parents know deep down that their child is autistic, and so many professionals and lovely, well-meaning friends chip away at that belief. The health visitor should have realized she wasn't qualified to answer my questions and referred me on straight away. If she had been more knowledgeable, she would have seen the signs, which include fleeting eye contact. She might have noticed he was anxious in the unfamiliar and noisy health centre and, instead of seeking comfort from me or playing with any of the toys on offer, had zoned out. He wasn't pointing, waving, looking to my face for reassurance or copying the other children. He stayed away from them. The whole situation overwhelmed him. Really, she should have taken me seriously because parents are often right in such situations. Certainly more often than health visitors who know nothing about autism at any rate. While many professionals were lacking in knowledge and highly patronising, and if they patronise me, a middle-class journalist, then I hate to think how they treat other parents who don't have the same privileges, others took me seriously. About a year after that first conversation with my mother-in-law, I went to see Dr. Stella Acquarone, who validated my concerns. I wish I could say I accepted my child's likely autism with equanimity, but I didn't. I felt a deep, crushing despair. Confusingly, this was combined with a sense of relief that someone else could see what I could see. I've never been in this situation before or since, where I was desperate for someone to confirm something that I desperately didn't want to be happening. Stella taught me that my son needed me very much, and that he was an extremely sensitive child. I'm so glad someone said this to me early on. While I felt guilty that I'd got him so wrong, it changed everything. She helped me start to see things from his point of view. Stella was our translator, mediating between my son's world and mine. I find it painful to think of what life was like for my son when he was a baby, with a mum and dad who couldn't know innately what was going on for him. I think this situation can make the relationship between neurotypical parents and autistic babies and children very complex. Parents can't seem to get close to a child who appears withdrawn, so they too withdraw to protect themselves from the pain of rejection. I imagine the autistic child finds the neurotypical parents too much, too unpredictable. They don't know how best to soothe him or her. For these reasons, I think it's important to register the signs of autism, some of which we list as follows. Listen to that small voice in your head. For me, this period of knowing, then not knowing, was the absolute pits. Things only got better once we knew for sure. Communication differences. Joint attention. Joint attention means sharing interest with someone else. A neurotypical kid might do this by pointing and demanding you attend to something they are interested in. Look at this train set, Mum. I want that. Come and see the cat running in the garden. The autistic child, however, might not make demands on your attention in the same way. They may hyper-focus on an activity, and if an adult joins in with what they are focusing on, the pair can communicate in a way that is meaningful for the child. Language. By 6 months, most children will have started to babble, repeating syllables that combine a vowel and consonant, such as ba, da, ma, and gaga, swapping them back and forth with parents and siblings, urgently expressing an unintelligible sentence, then waiting expectantly, with a serious expression on their face, to hear your answer. By 12 months, the first word has usually been said. At 18 months, that has increased to 6 to 20 words, and by 2.5, a child might have a repertoire of 200 words. At 3, they will be saying 3-word sentences, and by 4, they may be answering who and why questions. My son didn't really babble. I only realized this when my second son hit this stage and said his first word, tick-tock, after he was 2. Language is considered delayed if the first word is spoken after this age. Be prepared when talking to friends for them to swear blind that they didn't utter a word until the age of 3. Or to be told your child's delay is because they are a boy, if they are a boy, and everybody knows boys speak later. Language delay can suggest a child's neurology is different, but equally some autistic children have no language delay. They can be precocious speakers, in fact, with some autistic children speaking in full sentences from 14 months. It is important to recognize that speech, or lack of it, is not an indicator of intelligence. Non-autistic people often place such an emphasis on communicating that we tend to use it to judge lots of things that we shouldn't. Plenty of non-verbal autistic people have lots to say, given the opportunity to communicate another way. Some children appear to be developing words and then lose their language skills. It can be devastating for parents and for the child. In these scenarios, if you have early video footage on your phone, it can help speech and language therapists work out what is going on. Scripting. Autistic children do a lot of scripting, repeating stock phrases they've picked up, because it's compulsive, fun or soothing, or because they find spontaneous language tricky. My son loves to repeat verbatim passages from books or TV programs. All children learn language by copying, but autistic children often copy better. One autistic woman reports that as a child she holidayed in Wales with her family and within 2 days was speaking with a Welsh accent. Even as an adult, she struggles not to mirror other people's accents and phrases. Questions and echolalia. Autistic kids may also not feel the need to ask who, what, where, when, and why questions. Why questions are by far the most difficult, as they're open-ended. While autistic kids may ask and answer lots of questions if they are based on a particular interest of theirs, they may avoid questions on other topics they find hard or boring. A perfectionist child, and autistic kids are often perfectionists, might panic that they may not be able to answer the question. Others might be uninterested in small talk. Some children reverse their personal pronouns, using you instead of I when talking about themselves. They may also display echolalia, where they repeat verbatim words that they have overheard. This may occur immediately. For instance, they may respond to a question with the same question, or be delayed, where they use a stock phrase such as, "Do you want to have a snack?" every time they want something to eat. Echolalia is the child's way of practicing questions. Literal language. Words will often be taken literally, which can be a source of confusion when navigating a language as idiomatic as English. Skating on thin ice, you're full of beans, and it's raining cats and dogs are all phrases we use that, quite rightly, may be met with complete bafflement by an autistic child. Irony and sarcasm can also be a source of confusion. My son went through a phase of loudly exclaiming, "Not on your Nelly!" when faced with something he didn't like, such as the horror of finding broccoli on his plate. He looked puzzled when the adults around him laughed. It was a phrase picked up from CBeebies that to him simply meant an emphatic no. Related to this, some autistic children may be capable of reading words at a startlingly young age, but may not get the meaning. This is known as hyperlexia. Informing, not conversing. In older children, the words might be there, but they aren't being used communicatively. This can come down to a difference in preference between some neurotypicals who love to chat and some autistic people who prefer not to chat so much. These kids sometimes engage in conversation, but if you unpick the conversation, you'll notice it's different, says Lucia Santi, head teacher of The Grove, a school for autistic children in Haringey, North London, and the mum of a 10-year-old autistic girl. I sometimes speak to people working with my daughter and ask them, when has she asked an open question? When have you had a reciprocal conversation? Is the conversation her answering your questions? Watch how she's dominating the game. Nonverbal communication. This includes things like pointing, stretching out the arms to be picked up, waving hello or goodbye, or shaking the head to say no, things that are typically evident at about 12 months. Younger autistic children may show an absence of nonverbal communication or a delay in developing it. Facial expressions may be less animated. Eye contact. Some autistic people can make eye contact. Some can't. Some look at the space between the eyes or the end of the nose. Some stare, while other autistic children's eye contact may be fleeting. They may scan a situation looking out of the corner of their eyes rather than with a direct gaze. If your child finds eye contact difficult, other kids' laser beam gazes suddenly seem oddly intense. Toddlers begin to interpret different facial expressions by watching other people's faces, using this nonverbal information as a guide to behaviour. They study their mother's face for cues about whether it is safe to approach a stranger, for example. But this isn't something that occurs so much with autistic children. A study in the 1980s, carried out by Geraldine Dawson and Julie Osterling of the University of Washington, analysed home video footage of birthday parties thrown for one-year-olds. They found that a lack of attention to others' faces was the most powerful predictor of a future diagnosis of autism. Not making eye contact doesn't mean a child isn't listening or understanding. This may give rise to a child being described as a daydreamer or in her own little world, when in fact she might be entirely present but not making the socially required nonverbal signals to indicate that she is, writes Sarah Hendricks in her book Women and Girls with Autism Spectrum Disorder. This equally applies to boys too. Disengagement. The first time someone mentioned that my son was disengaged was a light bulb moment for me. I realised it was one of the reasons I struggled to play meaningfully with him. Few things in life are more frustrating than consistently being ignored by your child who has benefited from all your love, time and energy. Surely it's not too much to ask that you at least be the centre of their little universe. Feeling ignored is maddening, hurtful and, when it happens in public, humiliating. It isn't personal. You may be in an environment in which they can't cope, or your approach is one they don't understand. Play differences. The play pose of many autistic children will be head down, engrossed in a toy, or perhaps just one random element of it. For them, it may be a solitary rather than a social activity, though if you join them in playing with the element that they are fascinated by, they may love it. They may play with the toy in a way the manufacturer hadn't intended, such as laying a car on its back and spinning the wheels. The play may be self-directed. This means the child follows their own agenda, taking less account of the suggestions or desires of those around them and with much less copying. If the child is anxious, they may dominate play in order to regulate the pace of proceedings, making things more predictable and helping calm themselves. Some autistic children find it far easier to play with an adult or older child than someone their own age. While by the age of 2, neurotypical children often enjoy pretend play, many autistic boys and girls with their logical, literal minds won't see the point. A broom is a broom and not a rocket ship. You may receive a look of blank incomprehension when you try to pretend otherwise. Boys on the autistic spectrum don't usually engage in lots of pretend play, preferring instead to explore the physical aspects of toys, examining the screws on the underside of their toy fire engine, for example, rather than driving it to save people from an imaginary fire. Girls may appear to demonstrate lots of imagination, but careful observation will show a rigidity in their play. Teddy, sat in a circle for a tea party, will have to be in the same place every time, for example. They are likely to be in charge of the activity and unwilling to let other children mess up the setup they have in mind. Typical early indicators of autism and parental anecdotal reports relating to characteristics and behaviour from the book Women and Girls with Autism Spectrum Disorder by Sarah Hendricks. I think this works for many boys as well as girls. The parent feels a sense of detachment from the baby or young child. Often this cannot be further articulated by the parent. It is just a feeling of the baby or child being in their own world. Atypical eye contact, either unusually limited or staring. A lack of attention paid specifically to people and faces. Interest in people is not prioritized over objects. Limited interest and or response to people's stimuli, smiling, voices, peekaboo games. Limited reciprocal social facial expressions and social cues, smiling, pointing. Limited seeking out of people and responses from people. Very placid, silent and peaceful babies. It was spooky, it was almost as though she was a ghost just lying there silently without moving. Parent of a girl with autism. Or, very anxious, distressed and clingy babies. Intense emotions, especially distress and an inability to be comforted by affection. Atwood, 2012. Sensory preferences and intolerances. Small temperature tolerance range, which can result in febrile convulsions. Clothing, texture and touch. Physical touch, distressed by being cuddled. Specific strong food preferences and dislikes. Food and other intolerances and allergies. Cognitive differences. These are the differences in thinking and brain function your autistic child may have compared with non-autistic children. Theory of mind, different perspectives. There's a reason an autistic child won't draw your attention to the train they are playing with, according to developmental psychologists. It's because they lack theory of mind, that is, the ability to understand that people have different thoughts, beliefs, and knowledge to their own. The theory was formulated in 1978 by psychologists David Premack and Guy Woodruff, who were studying the ability of chimpanzees to infer what was going on inside the heads of their trainers. In 1983, psychologists Josef Perner and Heinz Wimmer extended it to the study of child development, creating in the process what has since become a seminal experiment, the Sally Ann test. It was perhaps most famously used by Simon Baron Cohen, Alan M. Leslie and Uta Frith 2 years later as part of their 1985 study into theory of mind in autistic children. Professor Baron Cohen and his team studied the responses of 61 children, 20 of them autistic, 14 with Down syndrome and 27 of them neurotypical, to a puppet play starring two dollies named, unsurprisingly, Sally and Anne. Sally had a basket and a marble. Anne had a box. Sally put the marble into her basket and then went out for a walk, leaving the basket behind. While she was gone, Anne took the marble from the basket and put it in the box. When Sally returned, the children were asked, "Where will Sally look for her marble?" Of the three groups of children, 12 of the 14 kids with Down syndrome answered the question correctly, 86%. 23 of the 27 neurotypical kids, 85%, but just 4 of the autistic kids, 20%. The other 16 believed Sally would look for the marble in Anne's box because that's where they saw it go. Why would Sally think anything different? The results suggested autistic children struggle to put themselves in other people's shoes or grasp that others have an alternative perspective, and as a result can't understand or predict their behaviour. Interesting to note, though, that a fifth of the autistic kids could, which is a significant proportion. But not everyone agrees with this theory. In an article for the Autism Education Trust entitled What is Autism?, a question it takes 12 pages to answer, the autistic academic Damian Milton argued that autistic people struggle to understand the neurotypical perspective in much the same way as neurotypicals struggle to understand the autistic point of view. He calls this the double empathy problem. Professor Baron Cohen explained to me how a lack of theory of mind affects day-to-day living. Without theory of mind, you will be confused by a lot of social interaction, not picking up on hints or people's intentions, which could leave you very vulnerable to exploitation, he said. It is what people call street smarts, being aware people are trying to deceive you or manipulate you. The classic example is when another child in the playground asks the child with autism if they will show them their wallet. The child with autism hands it over and then is surprised when the other child runs off with it. They didn't see the potential deception. Empathy. The ability to see a different perspective is part of what enables us to empathize, which is the ability to infer emotional experiences. Empathy is a hotly debated topic within the autism community. Baron Cohen divides it into two components: cognitive empathy, the ability to imagine someone's thoughts and feelings, which is theory of mind, and affective empathy, responding with an appropriate emotion to what someone is thinking or feeling. In his controversially titled book, 0 Degrees of Empathy, Baron Cohen argues that people with Asperger syndrome have difficulties with cognitive empathy. Yet when they are told what another person is experiencing, their affective empathy kicks in with no trouble. That is, they may not be able to read what you're feeling, but they certainly care. 0 positive empathy. He goes on to state that autistic people are the polar opposite of psychopaths, whose cognitive empathy is intact and their affective empathy reduced or non-existent. They're perfectly able to read what you're feeling, they simply don't care. 0 negative empathy. In his book Autism and Asperger Syndrome in Adults, Dr. Luke Bearden suggests we all have potential difficulty with what he refers to as cross-neurological empathy, meaning that while autistic people may struggle to empathize with neurotypicals and vice versa, it is less likely that either population will have a problem empathizing with members of their own group. While many of the autistic people I have interviewed reject Baron Cohen's notion that they have difficulties with cognitive empathy, two autistic women agreed. One told me she can only guess at other people's emotions, but that did not mean she wasn't able to be compassionate once she understood what they were feeling. The second, Robin Stewart, an autism trainer in schools, says that she did not intuitively have cognitive empathy, but has taught herself how to empathize. The ability to put yourself in someone else's shoes isn't always static. Many people can learn it. Executive function. Executive function is a term for the set of mental skills that allows us to problem solve, plan, organize, switch focus, self-regulate, and control our impulses. It can affect the big things in life, holding down a job and planning a career, as well as the day-to-day tasks, such as getting washed and dressed, doing housework and cooking. Susie, an autistic woman and the mum of an autistic daughter based in Northern Ireland, explains what it's like to have difficulties in this area. I have problems keeping focused long enough to complete tasks and tend to struggle keeping up with household chores. I can't seem to get on top of things. It's just so overwhelming. Filling forms, returning them, returning phone calls, and making or keeping appointments are the other things I find very hard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.